We're so glad that we could join us tonight, and I am so thankful that we can gather once again in the house of the Lord, and we can also gather around our living rooms and our devices, and we can participate tonight in another day with Jesus. We're going through 7 days with Jesus. It's been so exciting. I have grown so much during this past week as God has been teaching me and allowing me to just be able to share what He's been teaching me with you, and thank you so much for tagging along. And then also, I just want to add, if you could do us a favor, make sure that you tell everybody hello, that you've actually kind of signed in and said hello to everybody. We want to know if you're there. We want to hear from you. And then also, I encourage you, please share this. Invite your friends. Invite all those people that are part of your Facebook to join you tonight. It's just going to be a great night as we have communion together, online communion. Very, very sweet service tonight. And in fact, on this very night, this would have been the night that Jesus would have had communion, Lord's Supper, with His disciples. So let me give you just a couple announcements that I think that are very important for all of us. And we know that Sunday is Easter, and we're excited about that. And I want to let you know that we have had to make some changes due to the fact that there's going to be rain in the picture. So what we're doing is that instead of having the as we were hoping to have the drive-in Easter service, we're now going to be going online with that service. And so we're not going to be having the drive-in. We'll do the drive-in some other time when we have some wonderful weather. And, you know, the Lord knows all of our needs, and we want you to be in the best place possible to experience a wonderful Easter service. And we've got a wonderful Easter service prepared for you. We just want to make sure that everybody gets to enjoy it. And not do it in a rain event, not do it in a risky event. And obviously, even when we do something like this in the outdoors, you got to think about all the electronic equipment that we have out there. And we don't want that to get wet either. So we're going to be having an online Easter Sunday. So that's going to be at 10 a.m. Easter Sunday. You join in. It's going to be fantastic. And then, obviously, we're still going to have our sunrise service. And we'll be probably inside. Now, if it's not raining, I'm going to be on the outside, and we'll do that. And if you want to come at 7 a.m. and it's not raining, you're more than welcome to do so. We'll be at the cross, and we'll be celebrating our Lord, and we'll enjoy giving praise to the resurrection of our King. And then also, so I got the 7 a.m. service here. You see that on the screen. And so with that, we also want to let you know about tomorrow. I want to go ahead and let you know about tomorrow. Tomorrow, we're going to be during the message, what happened at the cross? And I hope you'll be here for that. It's Good Friday, and that's the day Jesus was put on the cross, nailed to the cross. But what happened at the cross? Well, at 9 a.m., I'm going to be speaking right here at Pearl Baptist Church, and it's going to be online, Facebook. I hope you'll join us. I'm doing this at 9 o'clock simply because that's the very hour Jesus was crucified. So please join us. Be part of that. Learn about what really happened at the cross. So tonight, we're about to learn about the Lord's Supper. And so I want you to gather your family. I want you to make sure that you've gotten your juice. Be sure that you've gotten your crackers. And we're going to partake of the Lord's Supper tonight. This is about Passover, the Lord's Supper. Jesus was with His disciples. And as He gathered with them in that upper room on that Thursday evening, He shared with them about how that He Himself is the Passover Lamb. You see, the tradition of Passover, or at least Lord's Supper, goes all the way back to Passover when Israel was in Egypt for 430 years as slaves. And God, through Moses, was going to deliver them. And so God told them that they were to eat of a lamb. And they were to take the lamb, slay it, and take the blood, put it on the lintel of the door and the doorpost. And when God saw that blood on that door, He would not bring the plague or death to that house. It was a Passover. And for centuries, all the Jews have celebrated Passover. Jesus is celebrating Passover with His disciples. And in fact, I actually have it set up for you that in a ceremonial way, we have the Passover set up. We have the ceremonial plate right here. And this ceremonial plate is a very important plate. In fact, I've got a picture of the plate that you'll see. And on that plate, there would have been these items that they would have been symbolically speaking about during the entire ceremony of Passover. And so this plate is very special to me. I actually got this, ordered this from Jews for Jesus, and I'm thankful for this wonderful Passover plate. In addition, there would have been the cup, and there have been four cups that have been used. We'll talk about that here very soon. And then, of course, there have been the matzah, and I'm going to be talking about that as well. I'm actually keeping it in this matzah coach. It's a matzah bag. It allows for ceremonial use for me to have the matzah inside. And then there would have been this other bag. This would have been called the apikomen and the ordi afikomen. Well, this afikomen would have been used as dessert, and we'll talk about that here in just a few moments. But when they were participating of, or all Jews are participating of Passover, they would begin by lighting the candle. The lady of the house, the mother of the house, would light the candle, and that would begin the entire ceremony. The father, he would use what is known as the Haggadah. This Haggadah that you see here, is this Haggadah means the telling. And simply, it's the telling of the story of, it's the telling of the story of the delivery of the children of Israel as God passed over their houses because of the Lamb. And so we're going to begin tonight in Matthew's Gospel, reading, of course, this wonderful, wonderful Passover event that Jesus partook of with his disciples. Here's what the Bible says. Now, on the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover?" And he said, "Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, 'The teacher says, my time is near. I am to keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.'" The disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover. Now when evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12 disciples. As they were eating, he said, "Truly I say to you that one of you will betray me." Being deeply grieved, they each one began to say to him, "Truly not I, Lord." And he answered, "He who dipped his hand with me in the bowl is the one who will betray me. The Son of Man is to go, just as it is written of him. But woe to the man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been good for that man if he had not been born." And Judas, who was betraying him, said, "Surely it is not I, Rabbi." And Jesus said to him, "You have said it yourself." And while they were eating, Jesus took some bread, and after a blessing, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood, the blood of my covenant, or the covenant, which is poured out for many for forgiveness of sins." So when Jesus was in the upper room with his disciples, he was celebrating a feast. There were seven feasts of Israel. This was one of the seven feasts. In fact, there have been three feasts going on during this particular week of Jesus. There was the Feast of Unleavened Bread, there was the Feast of Passover, and then on Sunday there had been the Feast of First Fruits, which, by the way, that would be Resurrection Day for Jesus. He's the first fruits of all those who have been resurrected. And so millions of Jews were gathered in homes all over Jerusalem as they celebrated the Passover. It may have looked something like this, as they gathered and celebrated the deliverance of all their ancestors from the hand of the Egyptians by God himself. And so Jesus comes and he's going to talk with his disciples and talk with them about how that he is the deliverer. And everything that you find in the Bible, it always points to Jesus. You go all the way back to the Old Testament, it points to Jesus. You come all the way up into the New Testament, everything just keeps pointing to Jesus. And that's what's the beauty of the Bible. God made a way for you to be delivered. And the way is Jesus. And the Passover, the Lord's Supper, is probably the greatest picture outside the cross of Jesus of us telling the story about God delivering us. And so I want to begin tonight by getting our hearts prepared for this Lord's Supper. And the way that we're going to do that, first of all, we've got to make sure that we're going to be partaking of the Lord's Supper in a very respectful and honorable way. In fact, the Bible teaches us in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, when we partake of the Lord's Supper, make sure that you partake of it reverently. And you see, you gotta know that the way you take of the Lord's Supper is not with lots of gaiety and laughter. You really take of it with some solemnity. You take of it with such respect. And tonight I've actually worn my jacket in respect of our Lord, in respect of the fact that we're coming to the table. He's asking us to dine with Him, have fellowship with Him. He's asking us to experience His love and His grace and His deliverance. And we come with great reverence, knowing that He is our deliverer. And the Bible says that we're also to come responsibly. Now, when we come responsibly, it simply means this, that we know that we are born again. All are welcome to participate of the Lord's Supper. It doesn't matter if you're a Baptist, or if you're a Methodist, or you're a Pentecostal, or you're some other denomination. All are welcome to come to the table. But however, the Bible does say that only those who are truly born again are to partake of the Lord's Supper. You see, the reality is that if you're not born again, the Bible says to partake of this supper, that is, the cup representing His blood, the bread representing His body, and you partake of that, you're basically saying, bringing judgment upon yourself, because you're saying that you do not believe that the blood or the body delivers you from your sins. So if you're tonight someone that's listening and you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, first of all, I invite you to receive Him. Secondly, I would say that if you have not received Him, refrain from partaking of the Lord's Supper tonight. And if you are a believer, then welcome to the table. It's a great night, and it was a great night. They had 3 hours of feasting as they gathered in that upper room. I'm sure they had lots of laughter and stories, and they told wonderful moments about miracles of Jesus. They looked back on His own life. And in fact, you'll find out in the Bible that not only were we to partake of the Lord's Supper reverently and responsibly, I'm going to jump down to the fourth one, but we take it reflectively. Every day's looking back to Jesus. We're always thinking back to who He is, what He did, and how does it work? How He saved our souls. We reflect back on when we got saved. Can you reflect back on that? And of course, we take of the Lord's Supper repentantly. And the Bible says that we are to examine ourselves as we partake of the Lord's Supper. Well, we really need to look inside our hearts. I was reading just the other day in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 17, and the Bible says that the heart is deceitful above all else. And you know, we all got to look into our hearts and ask the question, is my heart right with God? And if there's something in your life right now that's just not right, you need to make it right. And this is the time to do it. If you need to contact someone and say you're sorry, if you need to tell someone you're sorry, if you need to go before God and tell Him, you need to do that. And you're going to have time to do that as we prepare for the Lord's Supper. Because I'm going to ask you to simply just allow this song that I'm getting ready to play to minister to your heart. Allow it to just soak, allow those words just to soak in. And you don't have to sing this song, even though we hope the words will be on the screen for you. It's a hint that sometimes technology doesn't do what we want, but the words will be heard, and they do mean a lot, as it talks about a new song. This is a new song that's really a communion hymn written by the Gettys. I think you're going to really enjoy it. Let me pray for us, and then we will go to a time of meditation upon this moment. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just come before You. And God, we thank You that we get to gather together as family, as friends. And God, we get to gather as members of the body of Christ. Not just members of Pearl Baptist, but members of Your body. Thank You, Father, that we get to partake of Your Holy Communion. And Father, as we now come to the table, we ask You, God, to meet with us there. Speak to us there. Minister to us there. Lord, welcome us there and forgive us. And Father, I pray that You would cleanse us. Cleanse our hearts, Lord, cleanse our minds, cleanse all of us, and make us pure before You. We love You and thank You in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's listen to this song together right now. Thank you. While Jesus was in that upper room with his disciples, he shared with them about the bread. And I want to share with you about the bread if I could, and I want you to see about the bread, and I want you to realize that during Passover, they would put the bread in a matzatosh. It's interesting about this bread, it actually has three compartments. In each compartment would have been a slice of the bread. And so there would have been one here. There would be a second compartment in the middle section. There would be another one here. And there would be a third as well. You'll see that here. Well, it would be these would be eaten during the Passover meal. It's interesting, at the very beginning of the Passover, it would be the very center piece that we pulled out. This middle piece of matzah. Now, what makes it significant is that in this matzah toast, this was actually three compartments, and we pulled out the middle piece. It represents God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And the middle piece would have been pulled out at the very beginning, and a ceremony would have taken place about the matzah. It would have been broken. And part of it would be placed to be used later at the dessert. And this is a very important piece that would be used at the very end of the meal. And throughout the ceremony, this piece would be utilized for those to eat and those to partake. However, you know, what you need to realize is that when you look at this bread, you'll find out that it is so symbolic of Jesus. Everything about this bread points to Jesus Christ. In fact, you'll look at this bread, and this is from Israel. This bread is kosher, so it is indeed bread that is that's regulated by the Jews and is acceptable for Passover. And this bread obviously so represents our Lord. Everything about it represents our Lord. Notice that this bread actually is without yeast. That's why I asked you to have crackers. And that's why we don't use bread that has yeast in it. Because Jesus actually used bread, and the Jews used bread without the yeast. And the reason was because what it represented. Yeast represents sin. Jesus was without sin. And so he was said to be with no sin, or never sinned. In addition, this bread also, if you know here, is baked, and the way it's been baked, it's gotten striped. And the Bible says in Isaiah 53 that by his stripes we are healed. In addition, you can hold this up to the light, and you can see through it, because there's piercings all over it. Isaiah 53 says that he was pierced for our transgressions. Well, what's interesting is that it's not these first two pieces of bread that were used for this particular part in the story where Jesus breaks bread with his disciples. He actually uses this piece. And this is the piece that had been a piece of the dessert. And Jesus, the way the Jews would have done this is that in modern day, they would hide this during the supper time. The kids would close their eyes. Mom or dad would go around, and I think it would be probably dad would go around and hide this somewhere in the house. And then the child would find it. Usually it was hidden on the floor. He would bring it hidden somewhere in a corner behind something on the floor. They would find it, bring it back to the father, and then this would be the piece that was used for the further ceremony of Passover. Interestingly, this piece was redeemed by the father. He would pay his child $1, $2 or so for redeeming it and thanking him for bringing it. But this piece represented the fact that this bread came from the floor. Really, it came from the ground. And Jesus would actually talk about how that he would be put in the ground and he would come back to life. And that's the picture of what's been painted before you as this piece is coming to us to be used for Passover. This piece will be broken because Jesus would say his body would be broken for you and for me. It would be brought from the floor because his body would be put into the ground and it would rise again. Jesus was actually born in a place called Bethlehem, house of bread. So everything about this bread, it pointed to Jesus. It's as if that God was making a major statement to his own disciples and to the world. Believe in me. That my body has been broken for you so that you can have life everlasting. So Jesus took this piece of bread, and the Bible says that he prayed over it. And we know what he prayed because for the past 3,500 years, the Jews have had this prayer. And here's what he prayed. Blessed, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who bringeth forth bread from the earth. And remember, Jesus had just received this from the earth. And now he prays over it and he breaks it and he gives it to his disciples. And he says, and this is where we all do this together, so get your bread. We do all this together. And Jesus says, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Well, Jesus, as he was in the upper room with his disciples, he then would take the cup. That cup would be filled with juice. will be filled with wine. It will be filled with his blood, not literally, but figuratively. At the Passover, there actually would have been four cups that would be used ceremonially throughout the Passover. First would be the cup of sanctification. Secondly would be the cup of deliverance. It's the third cup, though, that Jesus would use with his disciples. And then he would take that cup, this cup of redemption. And isn't that interesting? With the bread, he redeemed it. With the cup, he's now also saying, I'm going to redeem you. Everything about my life is about redemption. And did you know that the Bible is all about redemption? Everything in the Bible is all about God wanting to buy you back. Because all of us have sinned against the Holy God, and none of us deserve the grace that he has already given. But because of Jesus, he's willing to buy us back if we will simply trust in him. So Jesus would take the third cup, and he would actually pray over this cup. And we know even what he prayed. He prayed this, Blessed O Lord our God, King of the universe, who bringeth forth fruit from the vine. And you remember, Jesus even taught his disciples in John chapter 15, verses 1 and 2. He says that I am the vine, and you are the branches. And Jesus really wanted them to understand that everything in Passover was really pointing to him. Now, in the time of Jews preparing to marry, whenever a young man wanted to marry a young lady, he would make a proposal, and when he proposed, he would take a cup of wine, and he would say, will you marry me? And he would set it before her. If she said, yeah, the way she would say yes is by simply doing this, picking up the cup and drinking it. And if she drank of the cup, she was saying, I will be yours for the rest of my life. And what Jesus is doing with all of us is that he's taking this cup and he's saying that this represents the New Testament, the new covenant in my blood. And he says, I want you to be mine. And he sets it before you, just like he sets this cup, my cup, before me. And he says, Hugh, I want you to be mine. And if I drink of this cup, I will be with him and live with him forever. And so Jesus prayed over this cup. We've already prayed. And he says, get your cup ready. He says, this cup represents the new covenant in my blood. He says, drink and remember me. Well, that did not conclude the ceremony. It continued to be celebrated. But after the celebration, all those disciples got together with Jesus, and they went over to the Mount of Olives. On the way, they sang a hymn. They sang together because they knew their redemption was drawing nigh. They knew that Jesus was not just their Redeemer. He was the Passover Lamb that would save them from their sins. And he's your Passover Lamb who will save you from your sins. What we can say is that the Lord is indeed worthy. He's worthy. And so tonight, as we kind of start wrapping this up, I wanted us to listen to a song. And if you would like, you're welcome to sing. He's indeed worthy. Worthy is the Lamb. And after this song, I'll close. And then I will look forward to seeing you tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. Listen to this wonderful song, Worthy is the Lamb. I'm going to go to the hospital. Give the Lord an amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And so tonight we conclude our Passover by letting you know that He is worthy. There's none like Him. And we go now and love Him, learn of Him, and live for Him. And so let's pray and let's send this all out to go do just that. And so, Father, we thank you, God. Worthy is the Lamb. Thank you for being slain for us. Thank you, God, for going to the cross for us. Lord, we'll never forget the day we got saved. And, Father, we will forever remember the price you paid. Now, God, get glory through our lives. And we pray it in Jesus' name. And everybody say together, amen. May God bless you. See you in the morning at 9 a.m.